Good morning.
Welcome to St. Martin of Tours as we celebrate the fourth Sunday after the Epiphany. Our liturgy of the Holy Eucharist Rite 2 continues on page 355 of the Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Together, Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Supplications of your people, and in our time grant us your peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
The word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "Ah, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say I am only a boy, for you shall go to all whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver my mouth, and the Lord said to me, Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now, we see in a mirror, dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, that I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, and the greatest of these is love. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. going to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is this not Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did at Capernaum.' And he said, 'Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown.' But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up for 3 years and 6 months, and there was severe famine all over the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them, except to a widow at Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed, except Naaman the Syrian." When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of town, led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Gracious God, help me to preach in a way that is good news. Good news to the poor, the weak, the widowed, the lonely, the orphaned, to those in all places and phases of life who are in any way distressed or vulnerable. Help me to preach in a way that honors and respects those who will suffer and maybe even die today for your gospel. Help me to preach in a way that seeks not my glory, but yours. Not the growth of this church, but the spread of your kingdom.
Yes.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. One of the things we treasure, if we think about it, is the ability we have to choose. We value our freedom of choice, and we use this gift hundreds of times each day. I mean, just think of all the things we have already chosen or will choose today. When will I get up this morning? What will I wear? Will I go to church? Where? Hopefully not that one. Where will I sit? Who will I talk to? Will I wear a cloth mask, a surgical mask, or a KN95 mask? Of the hundreds of choices on my television, radio, and computer, what will I watch or listen to today? What will I read during my quiet time? And the list could go on. We have so many choices, and I suspect that most of us choose most often that which we find most pleasing. If I like something, I choose it. If I don't like it, I won't. Don't worry, I'm not going to preach a sermon that encourages us to choose the awful, the lousy, or the dreadful. But I do think that in addition to what's pleasing, we should know that there are many times when God calls us to choose not just what is pleasing to us, mm-hmm. but what is fair, what is just, what is right. I believe that God, and our baptismal covenant, by the way, asks us to strive to live according to principles that are higher than pleasure. In the gospel this morning, Jesus preaches a sermon that succeeds in pleasing no one. Now, I've preached bad sermons before, more than I care to admit. And more than any of you would tell me because of your kindness. But I can honestly say that not once have I preached a sermon that so enraged the whole congregation that they wanted to throw me off a cliff. My goal in preparing and delivering sermons is that something good will come from each one. That we'll learn something, or we'll hear words that make us reconsider something, or will be inspiring, or will help us discern something that will make a difference in the way we think, or serve, or pray, or that makes us want to delve into it more. Some sermons are better or worse than others, of course, but I still want each one to include something worthwhile. In other words, as the shepherd of this congregation, I try to offer something we need, something that may make a positive difference in this world. I, of course, would prefer that you're glad to hear whatever it is I'm saying. But on that day in his hometown, that was not Jesus' experience. What we heard in today's gospel was that Jesus upset the people mm-hmm. by challenging some of their deepest convictions. They knew, and they were very proud, that they were God's chosen and special people. How dare Jesus remind them of the story from their own holy writings that in Elijah's day, mm-hmm. God came to the pagan widow mm-hmm. instead of an Israelite? And how dare he remind them of another story from their own holy writings, that God came to the Syrian, Naaman? How dare Jesus challenge their sense of religious and national superiority? How dare he challenge their sense of right and wrong, their traditions? How dare Jesus push them to lay aside their prejudices and see that God could work in new ways and outside Israel? One sermon, his first sermon in his hometown, and they wanted to kill him. I think today we have some questions to consider. How do we know if something that upsets us might actually be something we need to hear? Mm-hmm. How do we know that if we pay attention, if we listen to it and consider it, it could really feed us? On the other hand, how do we know that it really is off track, untrue, unfairly biased, or inconsistent with other teachings we've received, and therefore doesn't apply to us? Do we consider other information we've received from the pulpit, from a book, from the media, from our own experience that helps sway us one way or another? Can we discern whether or not something is what we need to pay attention to? How do we stay active in this process of listening and learning? How do we sort out what we need to hear from what is just pleasurable or common with the people we hang around with? And how do our responses affect ourselves and others? Today we have many things that are polarizing our nation. There may also be things about church that bother us. What do we do in our minds when we hear things that we or others disagree with? Do we shut them out? Or can we be open to possibly hearing something credible? Do we research the things we believe or the things that we don't believe? Do we fact check? Do we find non-biased sources, whether about the Bible or COVID or some other person? Do we pray and ask for wisdom from God? Do we choose to act in love? Today we're called to think about how we determine what is true and what is not, and to ask if our way of discernment is sufficient, or if we could benefit from a change. Do we know what could help us grow? What could be damaging? Do we seek our own pleasure, our own way? Or do we seek to love our neighbors as ourselves? Our lesson from 1 Corinthians includes that famous list of how we are to love. We've all learned that love isn't a feeling, it's a choice. It's a choice that involves intent, decision, and action. Love is the right thing to do, the just thing to do, the godlike thing to do. And this reading tells us that we are all called to love in all these ways. So, are we patient? Are we kind? Mm-hmm. Are we not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude? Mm-hmm. Do we not insist on our own way? Mm-hmm. Are we not irritable mm-hmm. or resentful? Do we not rejoice in wrongdoing but rejoice in the truth? Do we bear all things? Mm-hmm. Believe all things, hope all things, and endure all things? Even when we're weary or frustrated or angry, we make choices. Sometimes we make the loving choice, but other times we make mistakes. And then we have to backtrack, to try to hear what people are saying, to ask for forgiveness, and to begin again. It's not pleasant to admit mistakes, or apologize, or be humble. But it is a Christian thing. We must remember that we have choice to revisit things, to make things better, to learn and to grow. In choosing love, we need to persevere so we can grow into the people God created us to be. If you're like me, you love to hear that 1 Corinthians chapter, the love chapter, read. It's beautiful and it's inspiring. We even often choose to read it at weddings or funerals. But it's not just a grouping of beautiful words. Mm-hmm. It's something we are to strive for every day. It's what will turn around this crazy and wonderful world that we live in. Love. The choice for love. My friends, we know that each day of our lives, we have many choices. We're faced with many different options, many ways to choose that which we like, that which is pleasing to us, and we're grateful for those choices. We are grateful for the gifts in life that please us. Today, however, we also give thanks for the ability to make choices that are based on things that are higher principled than pleasure, higher principled than our choice. I'm sorry, than what would make us happy. We are grateful that God created us in a way that we can choose to do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with our God. Although it can be difficult, we are grateful that we can choose to respect the dignity of every creature. Today we give thanks for the opportunities we have to be patient and kind. We give thanks that whenever we fall short, we can try again. Today we pray for courage and for God's help as we strive to live according to God's definition of love, even though it can be hard, even though it can be more work. We pray for the courage to listen and hear those words that comfort us and those that are uncomfortable but challenge us to love more fully. May people not throw us off a cliff when we anger them. May we not get so angered that we literally or figuratively try to throw someone else off a cliff. May we choose to behave with love always. Amen. When you're ready, and if you're able, I invite you to stand and join in saying the Nicene Creed, page 358. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people today are Form 3, found on page 387 of your prayer book.
In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Church of the Province of the Indian Ocean. Remembering those on the diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for St. Elizabeth Higgins Lake and St. John the Apostle, Ionia. In St. Martin's cycle of prayer, we pray for Jean, Janine, Pam, Madeline, Jean, Barb, Judy, Sharon, Lynette, and Cecil. We ask your blessing on the work of our annual meeting and are grateful to those who prayerfully prepared reports and to all those who serve our church. Loving God, we pray for your holy Catholic Church,
that we all may be one.
We pray for those discerning vocations to ordained or lay ministry, for our vestry, and for all those seeking a deeper knowledge of God. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you,
that your name be glorified by all people.
Grant that every member of the Church, we pray for Michael, our presiding bishop, for Prince, our bishop provisional, for our partner dioceses and their bishops, Bonnie, Rayford, and Moises, for Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, and for Craig, the bishop of this area synod of the ELCA. We pray for the diocesan canons missioner, Alan, Val, and Anne, and for the clergy associated with this parish, Mary, Pat, Rick, Mike, and Bill. We pray for all bishops and priests and deacons,
that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for Joseph, our president, and Gretchen, our governor, for our Congress and our courts, that together with all people, we may rise above partisanship and strive to serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world,
that there may be justice and peace on the earth.
We pray for clean water for the world, ministry with community, and open doors, as well as the people whom they serve. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake,
that our works may find favor in your sight.
We pray for all who are aging, who find their bodies having more and more limitations. Give them peace and patience to accept their body's natural changes, and give them joy and laughter with their loved ones and caregivers. We pray for all on our prayer list. Barb, Jenny, Joel, Jova, Julie, Karen, Mimi, Pete, Sarah, Shannon, Stacy, Lori, Sandy, Jim, Karen, Carter, Joanne, Christopher, Sherry, Abby, Laura, Sean, Tony, Carol Ann, Christopher, Sue, Jeannie, Pat, Judy, Lynn, David, Bill, Laura, Ken, Sarah, Christine, and Bert. For those recently diagnosed with breast cancer who have asked for our prayers, Betty, Catherine, Carol, Linda, Paula, Eileen, Glenna, Sandra, Jacqueline, Sarah, Lois, Dawn, Mary, Krista, Amy, Laura, Marilyn, Deb, Beverly, and Donna, and for those whom we now name. We pray for the people of Afghanistan, Sudan, Somalia, and all others worldwide who are enduring famine, that food and medical aid will be provided to them. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble,
that they may be delivered from their distress.
We pray for R.J. Williams, Neil Cronkite, father of Steve Cronkite, and Otto McDonald, grandfather of Marcus Bagsley. Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Heavenly Father, you have promised to hear what we ask in the name of your Son. Accept and fulfill our petitions, we pray, not as we ask in our ignorance, nor as we deserve in our sinfulness, but as you know and love us in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Continuing on page 360, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone.
We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
What does the Lord require of us? To do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God. Amen. Continue with Eucharistic Prayer B, page 367. If you're able, please stand.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in your word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, a
according to his command, O Father. We remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with Martin of Tours and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation.
By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to sing.
Thank you.
the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
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 stand for the post-communion prayer from page 366. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated, unless you're celebrating a birthday or anniversary and would like to come forward for prayer and a blessing. There is a prayer for birthdays in the back cover of your prayer book. Please join with me in praying for Chloe. May I put my hand on your head, or do you prefer not? Thank you. Let us pray. Watch over your child, O Lord, as her days increase. Bless and guide her wherever she may be. Strengthen her when she stands. Comfort her when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise her up if she falls, and in her heart abide all the days of her life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Chloe, I bless you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You have the opportunity, not the mandate, to tell us the best thing about this past year, or a good thing, and your hope for the coming year.
Last year, I'm happy one.
Can Chloe use the microphone? We'd love to hear you better.
We'd love to hear her at all.
Last year, I'm happy I went back to in-person school. And this coming year, I hope to keep doing well in school and to meet new people and make new friends.
Thank you, Chloe.
If you're able, please stand and let us praise God for this wonderful young woman.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God.
Chelsea Wallace, and it's about sanitation systems, and it's about things we don't have time to talk about, but there's issues, okay? And so that's what it's about. If you've read the book, terrific, you know, it gives you some background. If you haven't read the book, come for the discussion, because you'll have points of view, and we want to hear them. And that's it.
Thank you.
probably know, our annual parish meeting is today. It will be as soon as we can get ready for it.
Mm-hmm.
We will, Joanne and Julianne worked hours and hours yesterday to get our sound system set up, and so this is going to be our first shot at doing a live Zoom in connection with a live meeting. So that will take just a few minutes to get set up probably, and then vestry members who are here, we're asking you to set up here in the front. You can bring whatever chair you like. My suggestion is that probably the choir chairs will be the easiest to move up. If you cannot move your own chair up, no problem, just ask one of us and we will help you get it up. You are welcome to, if you want a drink of water or something like that, to bring it in with you. Well, actually, then be really careful when you take your mask off. Excuse me. I will say that at 8 o'clock, I said, we'll take time just to let people walk around and get a drink. And after church, Roseanne said, what kind of meeting is this that people need to get a drink first?
Excuse me. Every church meeting.
After the blessing and the dismissal, you're welcome to get up, move around how you have to, but please come back as soon as you can so we can get the meeting started. And we do need to get people brought in who are coming via Zoom. Please stand for the blessing.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and give you peace and give you joy. The Lord's blessing be upon you.
I bless you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.